My name's Shane McCarthy. I'm a comic book writer, or a writer who does comic books. I don't know which way you want to say it. And for the last 3 years, I've been writing Transformers. Before then, I've written Batman, did some Star Wars, a little bit of X-Men stuff, a little bit of Daredevil stuff, a little bit of zombie stuff. So, yeah, it's been pretty busy. How did I break into comics? That's a tough one. How I ended up breaking into comics was I'd done a lot of the work, so you have to be prepared. Luck is generated, it doesn't suddenly appear. So what I had to do was I actually went to give up, and my father, who I later found out wasn't actually 100% behind the whole idea of that I would actually succeed, because it's too far away and it's too big, he said to me, you're not trying hard enough. If you really wanted this, you would fly yourself to San Diego, you would meet these guys, and you would tell them that they absolutely have to hire you. Okay, so 2 months later, I dropped X amount of grand, flew over there, and ended up, luckily enough, meeting the right editor in the right place. And again, luckily enough, my scripts were ready. They enjoyed some stuff, and they helped me with some of the other stuff as well. And then the next year I was writing Batman, so. I think from Australia, it was distance more than anything else. The boon that I gained from being from Australia is that I sound different. So over there I stood out, and I have a distinctive style of clothing. So people remember that stuff, though. It sounds ridiculous, but they do remember, oh, you're the guy from, like, you're the Australian guy, right, that wears the 50s clothes or whatever. Yeah. So it was good in that regard, but the difficult thing was we're so far away, and we're in Perth, which is effectively the Tatooine of Earth. So to get over there and do this, it's really difficult. But we have email, we have internet. When I first started, the internet was nothing like it is now, but I was still able to use email and these kind of things. So mostly it's about getting a face to a name, which is what makes it hard. The idea behind that was, since I'm a G1 kid, growing up with the cartoon series, which I adore, and especially the movie, which I love. I bought the soundtrack, I bought the DVD, I bought the American version of the DVD, I bought everything I could get. And when AHM was, I had that chance to write it, what I did was, even though it was in IDW's continuity, I really wanted to bring a heavy feeling of the old G1 thing, because again, that's what we all remember. So if someone walks into the store and they see Transformers, we all remember the cartoon. So I wanted to get a boyfriend that was in a bookstore with his girlfriend, and she's buying Mills and Boone or whatever, and he goes, wow, this is just like the old cartoons, and then, you know, we've got him. So, but the whole idea was, I wanted to see just how bad the Decepticons were, because it's all well and good to say that they're evil, but what would happen if the Autobots actually didn't get to stop them? So we start everything off where they've won, and so it's Megatron taking over New York and taking over the world and taking his sweet time doing it while the Autobots are stuck on Cybertron, unable to get off. All Hail Megatron was offered to me by IDW. Basically, they were in a situation where the sales on the book were going down, and they wanted to shake things up and make a change rather than thinking about cancelling anything or doing something like that. They said, let's get a new direction, let's try something different. They came to me and said, we know you're a big fan, we like your work, what would you do if we gave you the book? So I said, well, I'd do this, 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 and this. And in that first meeting at a party, by the way, I just went, well, this is what I do. I will call it All Hail Megatron. We do this and that and the other thing. And they loved it. They went for it straight away. So from there, I just outlined everything I wanted to do. I knew that I had 12 issues to tell this large story, and I wanted to take my time and make sure everything was ready to go, and just start layering everything until it all comes together in the end. So a lot of it was just about trying to get new readers in so that everybody could appreciate Transformers. I mean, all the Transformer fans want more Transformer comics, and for that to happen, we need more readers, so. My favorite memories of the Transformer cartoon, first of all, the movie was everything to me. So sitting in the movie theater, my sister took me to see the movie, the animated movie at the cinema, and she was like two rows back because she didn't want to sit with a younger brother. The place was empty. There was like three or four people in there. And when Optimus Prime, spoilers, dies, right? I was bawling my eyes out. Like, that was my biggest hero, dead on screen. Drift came about when, it was really simple. When I was looking at the Transformers that I wanted to use, and I wanted to use different things, it was really came down to noticing what all the vehicles were, and then suddenly thinking, Hutch, who did the covers for the series, is a huge drift racing fan. And it just occurred to me that why, if they're Japanese robots and drift racing is so huge in Japan, what if we had a drift racing car that could turn into a robot? It just seemed like a cool idea. Because when I first came in and I saw the book and realized that from my point of view, there wasn't a lot of difference between the Autobots and the Decepticons. They were both fighting a war, but I didn't get a sense that the Autobots were heroes. They were just on the other side of the war. So I wanted to highlight some gray areas in both sides. One of them was to highlight potential racism within the Autobots towards Decepticons. So what I needed was a Decepticon that was now an Autobot. Now, this had happened a couple of times before, but I wanted a fresh character that really just represented that as a concept, and fired it off to Chris Ryle and said, I've got this kind of cool idea for a Transformer, and here's what I want to use him for. Chris freaked out. But this will never work, though. Well, let's just send it to Hasbro and see. And so we send it to Hasbro. Hasbro freaks out, and the first day, we want to make an action figure out of this. So even before he was in the comic, they just went, we love this, we want an action figure. And then it came down to me telling Guido exactly how I wanted him to look. There was about four or five different designs that we went through until we found one that we all loved. Resurrect. Well, I mean, Optimus came back, so... Yeah. Well, Optimus keeps dying, so I guess you have to say Optimus because you keep wanting to come back, right? And I was really sad when he died. It was just the end of my world. So, I guess I'd say Optimus because he keeps dying. But the one that I'd like to kill, that's really interesting. I don't know. Because there's none of them that I really dislike. In a lot of shows, there's ones that I just don't like, and I think I just wish that guy was dead. But in Transformers, not so much, actually. And I've kind of got to kill a couple of them, so I know what it feels like. It was devastating to, spoilers, knock off Sunstreaker, for example, but I'm sure it'll come back. They're robots. I think humans in Transformers stories are incredibly important. You need a sense of scope, and you need a sense of relevance. Now, at the end of the day, I mean, if all we see is Transformers, one of the greatest things about Transformers is they're giant robots. They're not just robots, but they're giant robots. And you really want to see humans. You want to get a sense of scope. For me, maybe not so much the sense of how relevant is each individual human character, but I think humans need to take a part. We need to make them a part of our landscape. So I want to see Transformers walking down the street, you know, that kind of thing, almost like a Godzilla sense. But you have to have a sense of humanity in there, because at the end of the day, there's no girl robots. So, you know, let's get a kind of emotion and humanity in there. And it's interesting that Spike got a girlfriend because Optimus is really never going to get one. So, you know, I mean, I know there's girl robots, but there's not a lot of them. So, yeah, I think humans add a lot of spice, and I think they're very important. Price Transformer in my collection, it's a difficult one. I mean, I'm not a big toy collector, but I've still got all my original toys from when I was a kid. I loved the Beast Wars action figures. They blew me away. Like when Beast Wars first came out, I just didn't get it as a concept because it's like, but they're cars. But then when I actually saw it was Transmetal Optimus Primal, it was ridiculously cool. And so I went, okay, I'm gonna go buy this. I bought this figure. And then I was like, okay, I watched the show. And then the show was amazing. I mean, Beast Wars is spectacular. So I'd say Transmetal Optimus Prime is an important one. My original Optimus Prime figure I love. The first one I ever bought was Soundwave, so that's pretty important. I'm not really listing a favorite, I'm just telling you what I've got. But the new Drift toy, I don't get anything for it, but that is a cool figure as well. But yeah, let me say, I would go and say Transmetal Optimus Primal because it's probably the best Transformers action figure I've ever seen. I've got two what we call creator-owned books coming out, which means they're my characters in my books, and they're coming out at the moment. I am working with Marvel at the moment on a new miniseries, which I cannot talk about, but stay tuned, and finishing up on the Drift miniseries, starring Drift. I'm writing issue 4 at the moment. My editor is going to be aware of that. so issue 4 is due in 2 weeks ago, but hey. Drift, 2 books, and then Marvel, so pretty busy. We'll be right back.